think about it, we proved it last time, and now you see why I proved it. The intersection of two faces is a face, which means that this really is a binary operation on this set. And it's clear that this is the meat, okay? Because if you have a face that is contained in F and is contained in G, then it must be contained in the intersection. So it has a meat. How do you define the join?
Intersection is the affine hole of the joint of the union. The affine hole of the union.
Don't you think this is a little bit hard? It's like you take two faces and somehow you're supposed to make like a bigger face out of them. I don't see so obviously why there is a unique minimal way of doing this. But there is a very nice theorem on posets which says if you're a poset, if you're bounded, if you have a 0 and a 1, and if you have meets, then you have joints. So that means that we don't have to work. Because think about it. So I'm telling you that because this poset has meets, there is a simple way of defining this. How would you define it?
It's like the Morgan laws, isn't it?
I'm not sure actually. It's a little bit like that, yeah. But what you can do is just take the meat of all the upper bounds. And that's gonna work. And that's gonna work always for any poset. So the meat of the upper bounds of F and G. Okay. And I should say that again, so this is, if D is a poset, it has a 0 and a 1 and has a meet. Then it has a join. And so that means it's a lattice. This is a nice exercise, and it's not about polytons, you realize. This is an exercise about posets. Or the other way around, of course. If you have, you can change join and meet here, and it's the same thing. Okay, so that saves you work. This is a really useful lemma when you want to prove that things are lattices, by the way. Really, really useful. There's something implicit here, which is that if you can take the meat of two things, then you can take a meat of any finite set. That's not hard to see. Okay. So I proved it's a lattice. Let me postpone why it's graded. I'll show you in a second why it's graded. But so far we don't know. So this is done, but this is not done yet. B. Every interval is a phase poset. So imagine that this is the phase poset of P, okay? And now let's consider an interval which goes, let's say, from F to G. So this kind of, I normally draw posets like eggs a little bit. So there's like if there's a lattice, there's a bottom element, a top element, and it's kind of a schematic thing. And so the interval is all the things between F and G. So it looks something like this. And I want to find a polytope for this thing. So what I'm going to do is the following thing. Let me just do it step by step. Let's consider the interval from 0 to G. Okay. So why is that a phase poset? This is the phase poset of who?
Of G.
And again, you should realize that here I'm using something that I proved last time, which is that if you are a phase of G, then you appear in this picture. If you're a phase of G, you're a phase of P. Okay, so I am using that property there. Okay. Now let's take a vertex here. In the first level of the poset. Do the multicolor thing here. So, what is this poset here? If you were to give this name a poset, I think you would have to call it G mod B. And it's exactly that. It's exactly the vertex figure of G at B. And here, what am I saying? I'm saying that what are the faces of G that contain B? They're exactly the ones in this interval. And those correspond to the faces of the vertex figures. And then I just keep going up like this, right? So then I take a vertex of G mod B and I call it W. And now I look at this guy. And then what is this guy? Well, it's L of G mod B mod W. And so on. That's the proof. Okay? So that proves that. I think I'm almost out of time, or out of time already. But let me finish this proof because we're almost done. Okay. So why do I know then that this thing is graded? Okay. Let's say that you have a chain from F to G. Okay. And basically what I want to say is that if you take a maximal chain, then you better not skip any dimension, right? It should be like one dimension at a time, okay? So let's assume that you actually skipped a dimension. That's the dimension here, okay? Well, then I would just say, why is this not a maximal chain? Because if this were a maximal chain, then just zoom into this interval. Okay? That's the interval, that's the face poset of a polytope. And you cannot have a polytope that only has a zero face and a one face.
But aren't you using the poset is weighted for that proof? B?
Not really, if you think about it. Think about it slowly and you'll see that I'm not really using it. Because I'm not saying anything about the number of steps here. It's kind of, you can do an induction on how this poset is shrinking in size, not necessarily in height, but maybe in number of elements. I'll let you think about it because I want to just finish this proof and then we can also talk about it in a minute. But yeah, so basically, you know, if you had a chain from F to G and you skipped a rank, then this is a polytope, and this polytope has vertices, so just pick a vertex of that polytope and you will have refined that chain. Okay? So that's why the poset is graded by dimension. Okay? C. Take an interval of height 2. Well, we know that this interval is the face polytope of somebody, right? But it's of height 2, okay? So what polytopes have height 2? If you have height 2, that means that you have one level for the empty set, one level for the vertices, and one level for the edges, and that's it. You don't have any more room. And you have to have a unique top element. So, in other words, what I'm saying is that this is the face poset of a one-dimensional polytope. And there's not a lot of one-dimensional polytopes out there, right? So it has to be the only one-dimensional polytope that exists. And the face poset of this guy is a type. Because it has two vertices. So that's why every rank 2 thing is a diamond. And D, how am I going to take, if I take the phase lattice and I turn it upside down, and I'm supposed to make a polytope that has that. So can you think of what polytope that is? Whatever polar means, it better be that, right? It cannot be anything else. So basically that's the proof, okay? But that's not really a proof. This is the three letters of the dual, or polar. We don't really know what this means yet, so that's our next goal, to figure out what polar means. But so this is the polar of P. And what we will do next time is define what that actually means, what is the polar polytope, and then prove that, that it really has this property. But that's it. So that's kind of a quick sketch of the structural properties of this poset. I should tell you that this poset has more properties than what I'm telling you here. One of them is in the homework. I don't know if you looked at the homework, but there is a homework about this very strange property that this poset has. And so these are somehow polytopes have nice posets. So maybe now you believe me a little bit more, and you understand a little bit more what I mean by that. So let's stop there, and we'll talk about polar polytopes next time. ¿Alguna otra pregunta? Hablemos de esto si quieres. ¿Sí? ¿Sí?
Digamos que pues, podemos decir varias propiedades del polítopo dual a partir del phase lattice de pues, el opuesto. O sea, si digamos es reflexivo su retículo, puede decir cosas del dual o algo así. O sea, ¿qué propiedades se pueden deducir de cosas chéveres que tenga el retículo opuesto?
Pues lo malo es que todas estas propiedades son como invariantes bajo esa operación, ¿no? Entonces, si usted tiene un retículo y lo voltea, sigue siendo retículo. Uh-huh. Si usted tiene un poset graduado y lo voltea, sigue siendo graduado. Si cada intervalo es un retículo de caras, entonces al voltearlo, pues también. O sea, como que es ninguna de esas propiedades le dice nada muy interesante en cuanto a... No le dice nada nuevo en cuanto al dual. Simplemente como que usted voltea y todo sigue siendo cierto. Pero yo no sé qué no pueda sacarle mucha información nueva de esto. Una pregunta interesante es esa. ¿Cuáles son los politopos autoduales? Casi que les pongo eso de tarea, pero no lo hice. Pero les voy a poner a escribir todos los politopos autoduales de máximo 9 vértices. Creo que era lo que les iba a poner. Háganlo, es chévere. Pues ahora con esto sí se puede hacer, ¿no? Antes cómo lo hacía uno. Pero ahora ya sabemos que autodual, pues es... Uno trata de hacer dibujitos de estos que sean autoduales, y no hay muchos. Y entonces luego para cada uno, ojalá que puedan encontrar un politopo. Si no, entonces ahí pues más complicado, pero... Pero por eso escogí 9 o lo que era, porque... Sí, si el número de vértices es chiquito, todos estos dibujos pues son de politopos, creo. No estoy seguro, pero... Y eso es un problema abierto también. En el libro de Ziegler creo que sale como la lista de hasta qué número de vértices se conocen el número de politopos autoduales. Creo que se conoce como hasta 12 o algo así, no se sabe mucho. Los politopos autoduales como que no se sabe mucho sobre ellos.
¿Hay algún como programa, o sea, como que matemática le puedo preguntar cosas de politopos o matemática no sabe eso?
Qué bueno que me pregunte. ¿Sabe qué? Pues el viernes que hicimos la clase acá, como no había filmado la clase de allá, ya acabamos, como no había filmado la clase para mandarla allá, le pedí a un postdoc mío allá que hiciera un tutorial, porque hay un programa que se llama Poly.